Welcome to Hotter Than Hell's That 70s Month. Potter Than Hellions, welcome back to the Potter Than Hell podcast. This is Steve, your host. I'm joined as always by
BC
and
BB.
And on the keyboards tonight, this evening is
Dylan,
which I was supposed to record again tonight, by the way.
Well, that's not my fault.
I didn't think of it until just now, so fuck it. And I just want to say hello to everybody out there. Thanks for tuning in. Thanks for listening, sharing, interacting with us on Facebook and everything like that. It would be cool. Leave us a review, suggestions for shows. It'd be awesome. Guys, before we get going here, I want to remind everybody that on August 9th and 10th in Nashville, we'll be rocking Pod 3, and it's going to be awesome. Myself and BB will be attending, so we'll be there. Stop by, say hello to us. We got some cool new swag made for the expo. It's going to be fantastic. On the 9th is the pre-party, and here's some of the guests that are going to be there, and some of these guys are going to be playing at this pre-party. If they're not playing at the pre-party, they will be at the expo the next day. Michael Sweet from Striper, David Ellison from Megadeth, Brian Forsyth from Kix, Jason Bieler from Saigon Kick, Jack Gibson from Exodus, Rick Rule from Every Mother's Nightmare, guys from Roxy Blue, the guys from Tora Tora will be there, Toby Wright, the producer, will be there, among many others. So if you have the chance, come down, check us out. Myself and BB will be there. It's going to be awesome. It's great every year. Attend. It's going to fucking kick ass. What do you guys think real quick, the Rockin' Pod 3? I mean, what's your...
Looking good. I mean, Michael's sweet. Like you said, that's always... I think he's just... Something about him, just he's just a down-to-earth guy, I think, and he's always doing something. He's so busy, it's incredible.
Yeah, I wish I could go. It seems like an awesome event. I'm super jealous of you guys to be able to see Michael Sweet and David Ellefson and all these awesome people that are going to be in attendance. It'll be a really fun time, I'm sure.
Yeah, Chris really does a great job with this because he's trying to cover a wide range of music. You got. You're as heavy as Exodus to, almost as, light as, Striper and Kix. So, and everybody else in between. It's a nice little lineup, and I think they have a couple more people that they're going to announce. So, still more guys to come, and it looks like a great, great time.
Yeah, and there's going to be a bunch of other podcasts there, guys that we hang with, and, guys from Digital Killed are going to be there, guys from Matt Porter and those guys from the Kiss Room, Sonny and Steven from Growing Up Rock, guys from Ages of Rock. There's just going to be a ton there. And the main guys who are running it, Chris Senzak and Aaron Camaro, of course, of the Decibel Geek podcast will be there. So stop down. It's going to be just an awesome time. So I just wanted to throw that out there. And before we get going, guys, here, what are we listening to real quick? Dylan, what do you got going?
I've been listening to a lot of off-format stuff. It's honestly been crazy how much off-format things I've been listening to. But something that's in format, to just draw out of the hat, I guess. I was checking out the new Hollywood Vampires album, Rise. It was okay. Not quite what I wanted from a second album from them, I'll say. It was cool they covered Heroes from David Bowie, but...
Johnny Depp singing it.
Yeah, Johnny Depp singing it.
Yeah.
But it was okay. Johnny. It was a solid 5-6.
I agree. It didn't blow me away, but good nonetheless, though. BB.
I've been delving back to 1980, so this just missed the cut today. But I've been listening to On Through the Night from Def Leppard, their debut album. Really, really good stuff. For me, not a skipper on there. They're all rocking, and they have Rock Brigade opening up the album, one of the great heavy tunes, and it just gets better as the album goes on. It's a really, really great album, and not a lot of people kind of get back, they either stop at Hysteria or Pyromania, you know, they kind of forget about the first two, and this first album is really good.
All right, cool. Very good album. BC, how about you?
As you guys know, the last few weeks have been tortures in the music scene for me. Surprisingly, I've been rocking out some Pat Benatar.
Really?
I dug up greatest hits of hers. I mean, I was really getting into it. And in the last 2 days, REO Speedwagon live at the Moon Dance Festival. Hmm. I mean, there's a band that's, to me, it's very underrated. They got labeled.
Absolutely. They're another band that I think their ballads kind of just put them in a box.
But everybody knows them for the Can't Fight This Feeling and shit.
Can't Fight This Feeling, Still Loving You.
But like all the other stuff.
Whatever the fuck that is.
The guitar player just rips it up.
Dave Root.
But right. That's what I'm
excellent, cool. I have that that live one that it's relatively new, right? But I haven't had a chance to really delve into it. And Pat Benatar is fantastic. And I cannot stop listening to the new Rods album, Brotherhood of Metal, fucking kick ass. Yeah. And another band that actually the Decibel Geek podcast turned me on to, a band called Massive Wagons. Fantastic band. I think they got 3 albums out. And I was listening to the second album, Welcome to the World. Just a fucking great hard rock band. No frills, there's just great songs, great soloing, just right to the point, fucking excellent band. And I've been listening to some more Powerwolf, actually. Blessed and Possessed, I think the album is called. And just really good stuff. I love that symphonic shit. Fucking absolutely love it. So you guys, check out some of the stuff we're listening to. Dylan's checking out the new Hollywood Vampires album. If you guys listen to that album, let us know what you guys think about that album. BB's got a little Def Leppard On Through the Night, classic Def Leppard. And some Pat Benatar and REO Speedwagon for BC. We can't go wrong with those. And some Rods, Massive Wagons, and Power Wolf for me. And before we get into our continuation of that 70s month, we are going to take a quick break and do some news. All right, this week in the news, we got just a couple things here. Nothing real earth-shattering or anything. Slash, featuring Miles Kennedy and the Conspirators, they announced that they are releasing Living the Dream Tour Live. It comes out on September 20th via Eagle Vision, and it was recorded in London. And that's one of they're releasing that also on DVD and Blu-ray. And, of course, I have mine pre-ordered. Of course, I have to do that. I need my Slash fix, and this will be something I'll be rocking for the rest of the year at least. And the track listing on it is Call the Wild, Halo, Standing in the Sun, Ghost, Back from Cali, My Antidote, Serve You Right, Boulevard of Broken Hearts, Shadow Life, We're All Gonna Die, Dr. Alibi, Lost Inside the Girl, Wicked Stone, Mind Your Manners, Driving Rain, By the Sword, Night Train, Starlight, You're a Lie, World on Fire, Avalon, and Anastasia. Only one Guns N' Roses song.
Hmm. Yeah.
That's cool. I like that he's diversifying, especially since Guns is currently touring. Well, I don't know if they're... Are they off tour now?
Yeah. But I think they were doing some summer shows here and there. Yeah,
they were touring. So I think it's cool that he's giving his audience mostly all Slash stuff and letting the Guns N' Roses stuff stand on its own with Guns.
And it's kick-ass stuff. I fucking love it. And just let me throw out there quickly, his band is Slash, of course, Miles Kennedy on vocals, Brent Fitz on drums, Todd Kearns on bass and vocals, and Frank Sidoris on rhythm guitar and background vocals. Yes. So I just wanted to throw that out there because those guys, they're a fucking machine.
Yeah, they're like the newest super group out there. These guys are really fantastic. I love Miles Kennedy. I've liked Miles Kennedy since he started way back when. And this is a great set list. And like you said, Steve, I'm really glad that they're kind of putting the Guns N' Roses stuff kind of, behind them.
Like Guns N' Roses be Guns N' Roses.
Letting Slash and his Conspirators be their own band, go out there and just rock their tunes.
Wouldn't it be amazing if Ace Frehley did that? Left the Kiss shit behind and just did all Ace stuff?
Yeah.
Does he remember he's done anything besides Kiss?
He may not. Well, I'm sure the guys in his band remind him, but he just, I don't know. I don't want to get, that's a whole
lot. If Ace ever plays The Acorn Is Spinning, I'll spin in my grave.
Yeah, there you go.
they're a great fit. I think they're a good fit. And, Apocalyptic Love, what a killer album. And now he's got enough material. He's got enough material that he doesn't have to go back and rely on that Guns N' Roses stuff. So, you know, it's time to move forward and give the fans of what he's doing what they want.
Absolutely. And BC and I are going to see them on July 31st. That
you pointed at BB when you said BC.
I know. It was a general point.
And also, that was Dave Brosky you just heard, who may be in a future episode coming up very shortly.
Yes. Okay. Thank you, Dylan.
Yeah, because this is not the episode we're recording.
Right, okay. Yeah. I get confused sometimes. I had a little rough day.
That's what time travel does to you.
Yeah. And one more thing real quick here. Another favorite of mine and BC's, and hopefully some of you guys out there. I wasn't pointing. I'm just...
Now he's going to be a general pointer.
I'm just gesturing with my hands, all right? I'm just gesturing with my hands.
He misses his BC.
Yeah.
Don't take any pointing in
See, but you did...
Heart.
He's talking with his finger tonight.
Finger point, whereas with BB, it was...
But I wasn't pointing with the middle finger, so... Anyway, a favorite of mine, and I'll point over to the firehouse, BC's... Pretty Maids, they're releasing their new album in November 8th via Frontiers Music. And, you know, they pretty much said they're not reinventing the wheel. They're just, you know, it's the new Pretty Maids stuff, which is, you know, hard rocking, you know, very melodic hard rock band these guys are. And I think they're extremely underrated. And I'm sure we'll be seeing some of the songs that they have on this new album when we see them on their Monsters of Rock cruise. And I'm, like, really super looking forward to it.
Yeah, these guys, very under the radar. I remember I had their Future Worlds CD front to back. That's, you know, they're just one of those bands you kind of forget about in a way. You know, it's like, damn, the Pretty Maids. And then you throw them on and you kind of forget how good they are. But that Future World album, I think it was like 86, 87-ish. Like, there's a couple of good songs on it. Rodeo, I can remember. The Future World, I think, opens up the thing. But Pretty Maids, like I said, a very underrated band that doesn't get enough props.
Yeah, I still have to listen, like really check out Pretty Maids. since the last time we talked about them.
Yeah,
With you being the Dream Theater, these guys follow in that Dream Theater footsteps.
Theater follows in their footsteps if you put them in the same thing because these guys were first.
That's true.
Yeah,
that's
80, right. 87 Future World came 87. Out. Yeah, so. All right, guys, not a whole lot of stuff this week, and so we'll zip back into the show. All right. That news is, you never know what to expect, guys. You just never know what to expect.
What can you say about Sebastian?
Nope.
I don't know.
I don't know what happened.
We did talk about him last week.
That was last week we talked about.
That's okay.
Caught in a time warp.
That's okay. His mouth will probably be running anyway, so we'll probably talk about him again. That's maybe we'll call the episode. How about that, Sebastian? Even though it has nothing to do with it. All right. So this week, as you guys see from the title, I'm not sure what we're calling it yet, but we're going to talk about each one of us picked an album from the 70s, and we all had to listen to it and check it out as our fashion that we usually do. And we're going to go chronologically, and we're going to start off with Dylan.
Okay, so I was trying to think of some good albums to cover for this. A band that we haven't covered, mostly. I was trying to branch out. I was originally thinking Blue Oyster Cult. I couldn't decide which 70s album to pick with them because all their 70s stuff is phenomenal. Their first four albums are just absolutely amazing. And I decided to go with an artist that I'm really surprised we haven't covered yet because they're usually considered the second band, if not the first, to be considered heavy metal, along with Black Sabbath, who we also covered this month. I'm talking, of course, about Led Zeppelin, and the album I picked is their seminal album. Officially, it's untitled, but it's more commonly known as Led Zeppelin IV. It was released in November 8th, 1971 by Atlantic Records. It was recorded at the Headley Grange in Hampshire, London. 42 minutes, 34 seconds. Fantastic album. It's honestly, I was struggling because they also put out basically all of their albums for the most part, besides I think two of them were released in this decade. So I was like, what Led Zeppelin's album am I going to pick? And I went with four because that's the one that's most commonly cited as their best. Plus, it has the greatest streak, I think, of songs. It's really interesting because they put all their symbols that each symbol represents a single member of the band on the album cover. Mm. And it often sometimes is called Zoso because of John Paul Jones's symbol, which is a Z-O-S-O, very strangely, but it's what it's called. Okay, so let's get into some of the songs on the album. First song's Black Dog. Not the album opener I would pick. Actually, one of the biggest problems I have with this album, before I get into the positives, is the order of the tracks. I would rearrange some of the tracks, and I'll go through, after I go through the songs, what I would really do the order being. Black Dog is a decent opener, but I don't think it's the best song to open it. It has a really interesting time drum, drum pattern, because it seems like it's off of the guitars, especially during the it seems like the drums are off, but it's not. So that always was crazy, but it's probably one of their most popular songs that's often played on the radio, followed by another song that's one of their most popular, Rock and Roll, which I would open the album with. I think it's a stronger opening track than Black Dog would be. Just a classic song. One of the songs that features a guest musician on it, playing the rock piano, it is Ian Stewart from the Rolling Stones. So fun fact, you think it's John Paul Jones who always plays the keyboard, but it's not. The Battle of Evermore, I think, is probably the weakest song on the album. Still a good song, though. Some cool mandolin action on it. About the Scottish Independence Wars. Bet you didn't know that, BC. And then closing the first side with Stairway to Heaven, which I would have as the closing track of the album. I think it's a little better of a closing song than the one that they have. But that's an iconic song. You can't... There hasn't been a word said about Stairway to Heaven that's been negative until, I'm sure, Steve Wright has his way.
I'm just sitting here.
Has the double neck guitar going on, the Gibson EDS 1275. And actually, the guitar solo is played on a Fender Telecaster that Jeff Beck gave to Jimmy Page. Fun times. So side two opens with Misty Mountain Hop with that awesome electric piano. John Paul Jones, I think, is really underrated in the band as the bassist and the pianist and keyboard player. Some of the stuff that he does is so iconic that you always hear, Jimmy Page, Robert Plant, John Bonham. But John Paul Jones, I think, is somebody that should be spotlighted in this band as well. They're all masters of their craft. And I do like Misty Mountain Hop to bring you back from Stairway to Heaven, the epicness. It's a light song. A nice little palate cleanser to open up side two. Four Sticks, named because John Bonham actually plays this song with Four Sticks, which is interesting. Yeah. I don't know what that adds, as opposed to just playing with two sticks, but hey, it's John Bonham. I won't question him. He's better at drums than I am.
He can do what he wants.
Well, they don't have to layer them as much.
Yeah. Going to California, I always love this song. It's nice and light and beautifully arranged. I like it. It works better for me than Battle of Evermore. The vocals are a little screechy on the Battle of Evermore, whereas they're very nice and plaintive and soft and beautiful. And it's a really nice calm down before going into the epicness of When the Levee Breaks, which the iconic drum intro is fantastic. It was recorded, John Bonham was in the entranceway of the place they were recording, and they had microphones set up on top of the stairs, like hanging down. So that's how you get that cacophonous drum sound, and it's so iconic, and the harmonica in it is great. And I would just switch this with Stairway to Heaven and have this close side one, Stairway to Heaven and side two and the album. But fantastic songs. The only song I would really, and I wouldn't even get rid of it, I would maybe shorten it, would be The Battle of Evermore. I think it's cool to use the mandolin. It's an awesome instrument, and it really adds to the folky feel of this album, which does have a feel of, like, you're in a British
country house.
Yeah, like a countryside, and you're sitting on the porch, and the wind is blowing, and the grass is moving. And you feel like you're in another place, another time, almost. It feels very fantastical and almost Tolkien elements of, Lord of the Rings-ish type stuff, especially with the mandolin. I had to talk about Led Zeppelin because it's a band that we should talk about, because they're one of the progenitors of heavy metal and hard rock,
And though some of us at the table might not be well versed in Zeppelin, I think that it's important to bring them to the table in the discussion. Whoever wants to go first can go first. BC, I know you're a big Led Zeppelin fan.
This is going to be my pick.
And I'm sorry to take it away from
no,
you.
No, that's fine. Because there's quite a few picks. And these 70 albums, every one of them, except for Steve's, has something to do with me growing up and a time where I was at. In Zeppelin, there was some friends I was hanging out that there were like Zeppelin heads, I guess you would say, or Zeppelin heads or whatever you want to call them. They were all about Zeppelin. Here I am just like, you know, Death Leopard and Cheap Trick and Kiss and all this. These guys are like, oh, check these guys out. And they're playing all this Zeppelin stuff. And I just really got into it. I mean, like you said, they deserve to be where they're at. But like I said, you hit it right on the hit. I mean, every song on this album, except for that one, but I like the way he changed them up and Stairway to Heaven closed it out. But this just, when you mention this album, it just takes you back in time, for me at least. It's like all music does. To better times, I guess it would say.
Yeah, sure.
In today's world, but when your main thing was listening to music, in fact, I don't want to go back to those
when
days.
It was like the only thing you gave a shit about.
Yeah.
Or was allowed to give a shit, you know what I mean?
Well, you wanted to work to get money for music.
Right.
So it all came back to music. But, I mean, this is a timeless album by Zeppelin. I mean, like you said, I agree with you. I mean, there's maybe four albums I own by Zeppelin. This is one of them. Great pick.
Thank you. BB?
Yeah, definitely. This has to be probably the album of the 70s to have. I don't think there's a like the Battle of Evermore, like you're saying, just a little bit off. I think this is a fantastic album. Every song on this album is literally played on hard rock and, you know, classic rock radio stations all around the world. Every song, not a skippable song. I think if you're going to introduce somebody, like especially like the younger generation now, if you're going to introduce them to Led Zeppelin, I believe this is the album that you give them. The remastered version is fantastic. I love John Bonham's playing on this album. He's the all-star in my book. Fantastic sound of drums through the whole album. Totally different, each song. I'll just pick a couple just out of random. It's funny, Black Dog, great tune. Don't understand the title. Like, what the hell is Black Dog? I don't get it. You know, apparently I'm sure there's something somewhere written down that they explain it. I don't have a clue what it means. I just never understood the title.
Apparently, it was named after a dog that hung around where they recorded.
Oh, really?
Yeah. They
just call him Black Dog.
Black Dog.
I'm gonna go home and talk to Mike too. Black Dog. Hey, Black Dog. Hey, Black Dog.
Black Dog one and Black Dog two.
Yeah. Then Stairway to Heaven, how can you not talk, if you're talking about 70s music, you cannot skip this song. This is, you know, a highlight of the 70s, still to this day, still prominent in the music world. You know, bands are still covering this song to this day. And I actually believe that When the Levee Breaks is a great closer, because it just gives it that raw sound that they brought to the table. And the booming drums of this song, I just absolutely love. And fantastic pick, you know, and like I said before, if you're talking about 70s rock, you cannot talk 70s rock without this album.
Yeah, and I should say that it is the fourth highest selling album in the United States, behind, what do you think the three above are, Deb?
Thriller.
Yes, Thriller's number two.
One of them is going to be like an Eagles.
They're both Eagles. Okay. One is Hotel California, and the highest is their Greatest Hits album.
And the only reason that, I knew Michael Jackson's was, but the only reason I knew that the Eagles was because our buddies at Grown Up Rock just did a Diamonds album episode, and I listened to it, and I knew that the Eagles was one of them, so. Sonny and Steven, thank you.
Did they cover Rumors by Fleetwood Mac?
They did. They did.
That's a fantastic
album. They did all of them.
That was going to be
They skipped the shitty ones like from like country and all the pop shit, but like they did like all the rock ones. It was good. And that's the only reason I knew that. But, I mean, like, hey, for, you know, an English band to have the fourth selling, all-time selling album in the United States is just fucking crazy.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. I am, as you guys know, well, at least the guys here at the table know, I am not the biggest Led Zeppelin fan in the world. I like them. I'm not, like, gaga over them. I understand and respect their contributions to the everything that we listen to now. This is a great album. I enjoy it. And Dylan, contrary to what Dylan says, I do not hate Stairway to Heaven. It's their penultimate song. It is their, you know what I mean? That is what they're identified with, is that song. I don't think there's anybody that's ever listened to a rock song that doesn't know Stairway to Heaven. And it's just great. And I do agree that Rock and Roll, I think, should have opened up the album. That would have been a great opener. Black Dog is good. Misty Mountain Hop, I absolutely fucking love that song.
That's a great song.
I like the organ sound in it. It just has such a cool feel to it. I don't like Going to California.
Going to California.
I don't like that. I don't like it. No. No. Sorry. But When the Levee Breaks, that is probably my top two or three Zeppelin songs. Love it. I want to say that I think that this is the song that Michael James Jackson and Kiss tried to replicate for the Creatures of the Night album. I think,
like, the drum sound?
The drum sound. Okay. On, from this song.
I could hear that
really throaty, yeah, bass drum sound. I want to say that this could have been the template for them trying to get that sound for that album on the drums. And it's phenomenal. I think it's great. And you know, this is one album that you can't say, oh, it's overrated, because it's rated, I think, where it should be. Good pick.
Thank you.
All right. Chronologically, that would be BB.
All right. I kind of took Dylan's approach to this episode. We talked about a lot of bands through the couple years, through over the 100 episodes, and I feel like every once in a while this band is kind of missed our eye every once in a while. I'm going to pick Toys in the Attic from Aerosmith. It was released April of 1975. It was recorded in New York City, and it was produced by Jack Douglas. This is a great album. Aerosmith, this is their third studio album, and I think they're running on all cylinders at this point. They're musically, vocally, they're spot on right now, and you know what you're going to get out of an Aerosmith album. And I'll go track by track here. Toys in the Attic, they open up with the self-titled. Great song, fast, upbeat opener. I think it's a great way to open the album. Steven Tyler's vocals, really, really good on this. Uncle Salty, I love how there's always this crazy guitar riff in between the verses of this song. And I believe it has I think Steven Tyler once said it was about somebody who had an orphanage and were doing inappropriate things to the girls. So, you know, it fits their persona of, you know, what they're all about. Then number three, Adam's Apple. Once again, you got Adam and Eve sexual innuendos. Another great guitar work in this. Joe Perry just fantastic through his whole album. Song four, Walk This Way. And this is the song that put Aerosmith on the map in the 70s, and it put them on the map in the 80s when they redid it with Run DMC. You know, they did a little bit of little crossover. They're probably one of the original crossovers, because I don't remember, you know, back then anybody doing that. And that's, you know, to this day they're still doing like a crossover from now to like country. You know, everybody's doing a little crossover. So they put that out there. Number five, big 10-inch record. This is a funny little toe-tapper song. Has a great little horn section in it. Such a, like, a bluesy guitar solo. You got the harmonica. It's such a great musical song. I believe it's an actual cover.
It's a cover.
I'm not 100% sure who it is.
It's a cover of a Bull Moose Jackson.
Bull Moose Jackson. What a great name. And you can tell he's just a bluesy guy from down south. Then you get a Sweet Emotion, another great hit for these guys. You know, Walk This Way and Sweet Emotion, another 1-2 punch in this album. You know, great iconic songs from this band, still playing the record world, the radio world today, keeping this album alive, I believe. And then you got No More, No More. It's not bad. This one was my. It was good. It was just it didn't catch my ear the greatest. But then it picked up Round and Round. It's such a really, really good tune. It's almost like I get like glimpses and hearing of like John Corabi-ish, like like Motley Crue types sound when he was with them. It's very, very Karabi ish. And then they close the album with the. It's a great song. It's just a ballad. There's a piano and an orchestra. It almost, you know, if they kind of maybe flip flop round and round with that one, it's just one of those that doesn't want you leaving more, you know. But it's just a great song. They always throw that piano and orchestra in, you know. Even still today, they're, you know, trying to make the radio hits with the piano and orchestra, trying to hit the power ballad. But really great album in my ear. Great Aerosmith. You know, we don't talk about them enough. But Wrighty, what'd you think about this album?
I enjoy it. I enjoy it. I enjoy a lot of it. Toys in the Attic, absolutely love it. And this was an album when I got, I was like, cool. I mean, great start to the album. Toys in the Attic, just love it. I love the tempo change in it. It really fucking rocks out. It really sets the bar for the rest of the album. And then Uncle Salty, just dials it down a little bit. Not bad, though. Kind of bluesy. Not a huge fan of it. Adam's Apple, I think, is the gem of the album for me. Absolutely love this song. I love the funkiness and the groove of it. And I love the scream at the end. I love it first. Like, he goes really... I fucking love that. Like, that's one part that I... When I had this on... When I first got it on vinyl, I would just always pick the needle up and put it back just to hear that fucking scream over and over again, because it's so cool. I think that's my favorite part of this whole album. I love it first. Fucking just crazy. Love it. Walk This Way... you could say it's one of the original rap songs, along with maybe Rapture from Blondie. You can maybe throw that in there for rapping kind of thing. But they Run DMC ruined it for me, because that's the only version I could fucking hear in my head. And even when you listen to this song now, you find yourself singing it like that fucking version. And it drives me insane. Big 10-inch record. That's okay. Remember when we did the Faster Pussycat one? That was the song that they tried to emulate and didn't go as well as this one did.
Big Dictionary.
Big Dictionary.
Great song.
Sweet Emotion. Love it. Definitely a classic for a reason Aerosmith song. I love the talk box in it. The bass is phenomenal in this fucking song. No More, No More. It's pretty cool. A little mid-tempo little thing. I love the chorus in that one. Round and Round. This song does not fit on this album. I hate to say it's too heavy for this album, but this song sounds like it was not recorded with the rest of these songs. It just, in my head, it just does not fit on this album. It's way too fucking gloomy for fucking Aerosmith. And You See Me Crying, I hate it. I fucking hate it. And you're right, BB. Like, I mean, you say for You See Me Crying... doesn't leave you wanting more. Like, the last two songs make me want to listen to the first part of the album again, but not like I want more songs. But I like it. You know, it's good. Just a couple little bumps in the road for it, but the songs that are great are really fucking great.
Yeah, I think I agree. For an album that's considered one of Aerosmith's best, there are a lot of songs that aren't on the same caliber as the best songs on this album. I mean, Toys in the Attic is a fantastic opener. One of their best album openers, I think, for sure. Uncle Salty just brings it down for... I don't like that song at all. It's so slow, and especially after the energy of Toys in the Attic, you're going from 100 on a freight train to...
The two guys jacking.
You tripped and ended up on the push-pull, the cart, or whatever the hell it is. Adam's Apple is good, though. That does pick it up. And Walk This Way is classic. Plus, they got the name from it, from Young Frankenstein. They were watching that movie, and Marty Feldman's character was like, walk this way. This way. Big 10-inch record, I don't like it. Sorry, guys. Maybe Big Dictionary ruined it for me.
Another great song. Ruined. Yeah.
Sweet Emotion, though, is a classic. Actually got to see Alice Cooper sing it live when we saw Hollywood Vampires.
Oh, yeah.
That was very interesting, to say the least.
It was very
cool, though.
It was a different arrangement, too.
Yeah, it was. Yeah. Really awesome, though.
I forgot about that.
No More, No More is the lesser-known song on this album for me that I like a lot. It reminds me a little bit of No Surprise, a bit, off of Night in the Ruts.
Just a little bit.
Maybe the chorus.
Yeah, the chorus is what I'm thinking. But it's a great song. And yeah, the last two songs kind of drop off for me. But it's... I have to basically mimic what you said. When it's good, it's fantastic. Some of Aerosmith's best, but there's also a lot of flack on the album.
And the thing that sticks in my mind the most about this is the first Aerosmith album was like, okay, you know. And Steven Tyler sounded totally different on that album.
Oh, yeah.
And then Get Your Wings, way better. And then this one, stepping it up.
And then Rocks,
when you get the
best.
Fucking Rocks, it's like all bets are off. Just like total, you know, this is the album that got them just about to the top of the hill, and then fucking Rocks just fucking pushed them over.
Yeah, Rocks is my favorite Aerosmith
album. But
good
pick, though, BB.
Also, Rock. BB, I'm very disappointed that it wasn't Rats Round and Round.
So was Steve.
Points Steve. Off for not inventing a song that wouldn't come for another couple of years.
True.
My first experience with Aerosmith was the Greatest Hits. Is that what it's called?
Mm-hmm. The Red Album, right?
Yeah.
Red
and
White.
And then the classic Dome and Mirrors. This is my first Aerosmith album I got after Dome and Mirrors. And I guess it starts off with Toys That I Crank It. I guess name my favorites Adam's Apple, Walk This Way. Yeah, I think I don't hear the rap version like you said. I guess I don't know. That's one that's, I think it's been played so much. Big 10-inch, I like to cover that. Sweet Emotion to me is one of my top five Aerosmith songs. No matter how many times you hear it, you don't get sick of it. No More, No More is great, and like I said, I agree with everybody else here. Maybe not everybody, but the last two songs just leave you wanting more. But like you said, I love the way that was put together and it got me into Aerosmith and the older Aerosmith. Which pretty much I like everything but everything from Permanent Vacation and back. But overall, great 70s album.
All right, great two picks. And we're halfway through the century of the 70s, and let's break for our hidden gem.
All right, this week's hidden gems. Let's see what Steve has this week.
Me? What do I have?
What do you have?
Since I've been listening to the new Rods album, I've been delving back a little bit into their catalog, and I really want to throw this album out there. I think it's great. Someone may have even had it as a gem before. What are you shaking your head for?
No, I didn't have another idea for a gem. Sorry, go ahead.
Oh, all right. Thank God, because the one you had sucked.
You didn't even listen to it.
I heard it. I heard enough of it to think
you
it
heard
sucked.
Like the worst part of it.
And this is a Rod's album. Came out in 1982, and it's the first full album featuring Gary Bordano. I'm sorry for the pronunciation, Gary, on bass. And it's the Wild Dogs album by the Rods. Just a rocking album, front to back, opens up with Too Hot to Stop. Like some of the key songs on there for me are Violation, Wild Dogs, and Sweet Talk Honey is fucking excellent. It's just a great hard rock album, and they do a version of You Keep Me Hanging On from, it's actually the Supremes cover, but Vanilla Fudge did probably the best known rock version of it. Just a great album, so the Rods, Wild Dogs. Check it out.
Wild nice. Dogs Cried in the Night.
Mm-hmm. That's a J.Y. Young song.
What? Easy, J.Y.
He has a song called Wild Dogs.
Oh, okay. I was quoting Africa by Toto.
Oh, do you remember that? Do you remember that song, BC? Wild Dogs from J.Y. Young? Remember? It was a video that was on MTV on Headbangers Ball.
If you put it on right now,
I'll have to throw it out for you.
No. How can you go around with the Rods? BB, what do you got for us?
All right, I really had to dig deep into this one. I wanted to kind of keep it around the 70s theme here. I found this band out of England. They are Atomic Rooster. And the album I want to talk about is On Air, live at the BBC.
Huh.
So when you have BB and BC together, you know, it's got to be good. And these guys are really fantastic live. They're almost like a cross between like a Deep Purple, a very heavy organ sounding, and maybe like a Jimi Hendrix. Really cool. Some guitar work on this album is really great. As Apple Music says, it was released in 2018, but it was recorded back in the 70s. So There's a whole bunch of songs that nobody's ever heard of, but give it a listen. It's really, really cool. They're called Atomic Rooster.
Interesting.
Live at the BBC.
The BBC. It's got BC in it. How could it be wrong? interesting. We'll definitely check that out. Dylan, what do you got for us?
Okay.
So I know you're excited about this.
I had something completely unrelated originally as a hidden gem, but then I realized, oh shit, there is a really good hidden gem that is directly connected with my pick for tonight. And you've all listened to it before. It's from a band that we all admire. It's Great White's Great Zeppelin, a tribute to Led Zeppelin. Fantastic versions of these songs. They do a lot of the songs that we talked about tonight, like My Dad's Favorite, Going to California. They do When the Levee Breaks, Stairway to Heaven. But they also do The Immigrant Song, No Quarter, Since I've Been Loving You, which is my favorite Led Zeppelin song of all time. It's a fantastic live album, and Jack Russell's voice is perfectly suited to sing Robert Plant songs.
Fantastic. Since I've Been Loving You is phenomenal on there.
I love that song so much, and they do it justice in the best sense. So, Great Zeppelin, a tribute to Led Zeppelin by Great White.
Phenomenal. I love that album. I'm going to go totally off out of the 70s for my pick.
DC wants out.
But if anything's going to be 70s, I was looking through vinyl when I came across this album, and it just brought me back to the album that came out in 1985. Some Pennsylvania boys from Lansdale, Pennsylvania, back in 1983, they got together and called themselves T's. Their self-titled debut came out in 1985, which later on, anybody follows knows these guys, they changed themselves to 1988 for some kind of unknown reason. I'm not 100% sure, the Rough House. And they got back together probably a good 15 years ago. They do oddball shows every now and then, but T's self-titled, it's kind of like a heavier glam rockish type music, Midnight Madness, When the Moon Is Full, looking for BB's always looking for action.
That's right.
I mean, it's just, there's not a bad song on this. Even the slow one, Someday Somewhere. But you can still get this. It's on Discogs. It's for sale out there. But check these guys out, Pennsylvania Rock.
Yeah, that Midnight Madness song. Yeah, I do know that song. It's really, really good. And I'm not and I don't even remember where I got it.
You're not even sure. Huh. I told you, you still remember.
Yeah, you probably did.
I wonder if they're the T's that were on the Kiss Cruise last year. I don't think so. I think it's spelled different. It was T-E-E-Z-E, right?
This is how they spell it, but
right?
They can't use that.
Because there was a band T's on the Kiss Cruise last year.
That might be why these guys can't use it.
It could be. It could be.
It was something like some other.
Someone else already had it or something like that. Yeah.
There it is.
BB's listening to it right now.
Let's do it right now, bitches.
So sorry.
No, because that's why they can't go. They had to switch to Rough House in 1988. Might be
because. Maybe the because of them. Yeah, yeah.
It might be because of the tease that was on the cruise. But
we skipped them, by the way. We didn't see them.
But, there you go. There's our hitting gems for this week. Steve had the Rods with the Wild Dogs. BB with an old school type one, Atomic Rooster, live at the BBC and other transmissions. Dylan with a great band, Great White, doing a tribute to another great band, Led Zeppelin, live. And I had some Pennsylvania rock with the guys with T's with their self-titled album from 1985. And here we go, back into our episode.
All right, we're going chronologically, so the next album will be mine, and I'm going to, and I kind of went with what these guys were kind of doing, talk about a band that I think I talked about these guys briefly because I saw them in concert last year, and warning on this album, there are several skippable songs, said about Toys in the Attic, I think the ones that are great are so fucking excellent that you can definitely overlook and skip the ones that suck. Some people may like them, but I'll get into it. I picked Steve Miller Band, Fight Like an Eagle album. Steve Miller Band was an absolute fucking hit machine. 70s, into the 80s, just a great good time feeling band. You can tell like a lot of these songs, you know, they're you know, you could picture, and I'm not a pot smoker, but you could picture dudes getting fucking high and token up listening to some of this shit. And I think it's excellent, and it's produced by Steve Miller. And it's not a long album. It's only like 38 minutes long, which is a really short album. But it's good. It's and mercifully, a lot of the crappy songs are really short. So even if you just listen to it all the way through, the crappy songs kind of go by really quickly. And some of the better ones are a little bit longer. And it starts out with a space intro, which if you hear this song on the radio, you always hear this intro before you hear the song come on. So they always play like the two together, and then it goes right into the title track, Fly Like an Eagle. It's got like a groovy feel to it, and this album for me speaks and yells summer. Like, you listen to this, you think, you know, outside at a beach or a pond or a park or something like that, and just like kind of chilling, having a couple beers, or, you know, if you have like a little toke, you know, that's legal in most states now anyways. And I really like how the synthesizer and the keyboards like have the little like gets really fucking loud towards the end of the song, and that the fade out is really cool on there. It goes into Wild Mountain Honey. It's got a sitar in the song. It's got a kind of an Indian feel to it. I would say that and no offense to anybody out there, like the potheads would fucking love this song. Just the way that it comes across. And one of the gems on the album for me is the next song, Serenade. Love it. I love the jangly guitars in it. It's amazing. Like, the vocals in this song are like so layered, just like perfect. I think it's a fantastic song. Definitely an underrated song for the Steve Miller Band. Dance, Dance, Dance. I think this is like a country song, and he kind of sings it like an auctioneer when you listen to him sing. And it's actually not too bad, and it's mercifully short. It's, you know, it's a short song. And Mercury Blues, I think, is a really good bluesy song. It's got a funky guitar in it. The background vocals are great. I could really see them, if they play this in concert, like stretching this song out with some guitar soloing and some keyboards back and forth and stuff. I think it would be really cool. And then the next song, it's a song about Billy Joe and Bobby Sue, two young lovers with nothing better to do. Take the money and run. It's got as soon as you hear the drum beat and the banging of the song, you know exactly what the fuck it is. It's just fucking iconic. It's excellent. I think it's an amazing song. It's I like the little things, like the hand claps in it. Just like a really cool song, a very, very memorable song, and for a reason, one of his most well-known songs. And it goes right into Rockin' Me, another fucking great song. It still has that same jangly guitar sound to it. I love the vibe of it. You Send Me an Old Sam Cooke Song. It's fucking terrible. Sorry, Sonny. It sucks ass. Blue Odyssey is a little, like, a minute keyboard thing, which is, you know, just... I think it was just to take up space on the fucking album. Sweet Marie. Right? Yeah, Sweet Marie. It's got a great harmonica in the beginning of it. Like, kind of a slow, bluesy song. It's not too bad. And the last song on it is The Window. I think it's a... kind of a really cool song. It's kind of, you get that vibe that they're looking out the window of, like, say, like a spaceship or a satellite looking down on the Earth, and then the album ends and you can just kind of picture them just kind of floating away. And it's a great album, and I just wanted to pick something different from, you know, all the hard rock stuff that we do. Just a great classic rock album. I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, this I really, in the early 80s, I really got into Steve Miller Band. So I was very familiar with this one. Fly Like an Eagle is one of those iconic songs that he's done. That classic opening guitar riff, you know exactly what song it is, you know who it is, which always kind of blew my mind. Like, all these bands we're talking about today, you see the lead singer, you see the guitar player, you know who these guys are. If I ran Steve Miller over today, I wouldn't know what he looks like. I don't think I've ever seen a real picture of Steve Miller. We saw him live. This is way back, probably like maybe right around the beginning when Montage was doing concerts. It was probably like 90, early 94, 95. He played down there, and halfway through there was a big humongous thunderstorm, but he kept playing, but he went acoustic for the rest of the show. It was really, really cool. But yeah, like I said, I don't know. Steve Miller's very secretive. I don't know what he's not out there. He doesn't put himself out there. But yeah, back to the music. Wild Mountain Honey, a psychedelic song with a little electric sitars, you know, like you said, it's, you know, it's out there for the pot smokers, because I'm sure the Wild Mountain Honey has something to do with the dew on the buds of the pot plant, but you know, that's neither here nor there. Then Serenade at least picks it up as a really good upbeat song that brings it back to how Steve Miller plays. Dance, 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 it's like a southern rock song. You could see it in like the backwoods of a bayou type scenery. Mercury Blues, it's a cover of a K.K. Douglas Trio song. It's about the Ford Motor Company in Detroit, you know, just talking about, you know, the working guy and the cars that they're producing. Take the Money and Run, one of his another iconic songs. And then Rockin' Me. Good opening guitar riff is so cool. And that's another one. You hear that opening guitar riff, you know that's a Steve Miller Band. And which would be great if they stopped the album right there.
Mm-hmm.
Just cut it at number 8.
Cut it off at 8.
You Send Me the Old Sam Cooke cover. It's all right. You know, it's nothing that you're, you know. I think it's a lot shorter than the original. Then you have the Blue Odyssey of the instrumental and the Sweet Marie, the little harmonica, cool bluesy song, and another backwoods bayou type thing. And the window about outer space is cool, but I think it'd be a lot better if they close it with Rockin' Me. Mm-hmm. BC,
I never saw this coming. Steve Miller, this takes me back to being out of high school and my first full-time job. Third shift, you always heard this, and like I said, take the money and run. You heard that a million times a night. Yeah, right. But so I mean, this was like a total surprise. I mean, like you said, a lot of it a little stonerish, but I like take the money and run. But my favorite off this would be Rockin' Me, and then of course the title track, the ones I'm most familiar with. Like I said, I agree with you. I cut the album shorter, and those last four songs they didn't do nothing for me. I mean, when it comes to Steve Miller, I really got into the Book of Dreams, which I think is the next album after this.
Maybe.
There's a lot of, I mean.
Yes.
Thank you. There's a lot of good sounds off that album, too, when it comes to Steve Miller.
Right.
But, yeah. Cool. I never saw this coming.
Surprise.
Surprise.
The songs I liked. Fly Like an Eagle was the first Steve Miller Band song I ever heard. It was on the soundtrack of the movie Space Jam. Come On and Slam and Welcome to the Jam. It's when Michael's really getting his groove back and he's like, okay, Looney Tunes, Toon Squad, we're going to beat the Monstars and let's play some basketball. And then I want to fly. As Jordan's dunking all over Bugs Bunny. Serenade, great song. I like that song a lot. Mercury Blues isn't too bad. Take the Money and Run is a classic. The hand claps are what do it for me whenever they do a location. That's how I figured it out. I was always like, when do they do the hand claps? When does it come in? It's every time they mention a location. So down Texas.
Philadelphia, yeah.
So
maybe we should do that. If we mention any where we're recording from, we'll put the claps in.
Or whenever we say, so no one told you life was going to be this way. Rockin' Me, fantastic song. I absolutely agree that it should end the album. And things I don't like on the album. Basically, the rest of the album. Everybody's talked about You Send Me. What really annoys me about that, there's a sample of a bit from a Cheech and Chong album that's layered on top of that song. And it doesn't mesh well at all.
Oh, is that what that weird thing is?
Yeah, it's a bit from apparently their routine Championship Wrestling. From their wedding.
I was wondering what the hell that was. It was really weird.
Yeah, it comes out of nowhere. It immediately takes you out of the song. Not that the song's that amazing to begin with. There's just a lot of filler on this 38-minute album, which is not good. If your album's 38 minutes, and there's like half of your album is filler.
You have half of a greatest hits album on like one album. It's crazy.
If anybody wants to make the... The argument that people should just release singles anymore, not albums, you could point to this album, and that would be the case. Honestly, with Steve Miller Band, sometimes his voice grates on me. And a lot of the songs in this album, his voice was grating on me. but the songs that are great are fantastic. They're classics, songs that everybody knows. But the songs that aren't well known, well, they're not well known for a reason. But that's not our last album tonight, BC. I believe you have the last album tonight.
Last but not least.
I'm taking up the rear here and the last.
You're what?
The rear.
You're what?
What are you doing? In the last year of our. The first month of
our
the
decade.
Last year. Of our decade here. I'm going to go with the typical BC hard rock with the Scorpions from 1979, Lovedrive. Again, back then, albums were no more than a little bit over a half hour. I think this is only 36 minutes and 30 seconds. Came out in January of 79, so. I'm going to kill the producer's name, so I'm going to ask Dylan to help me out here.
So the guy from Germany.
Dieter Dierks.
Yeah, Dieter Dierks.
Say that three times
fast. Dieter.
Dieter.
Anyways.
So it was the Sprockets.
Again, like I mentioned probably about three, four times already. This takes me back to, I mean, my first experience, I think, with Scorpions is, of course, Rocky Like a Hurricane, I think. I know what the guy, back in the day, I was maybe 16, he might have been 17. He had a truck, so we used to cruise around, just drive around. And he was a huge Scorpions guy. This is the, and he goes, oh, you gotta hear this album. Because I was always talking about, well, was, you know.
The hits.
The hits. So he goes, oh, check this out. I remember we used to cruise from here to Binghamton, New York, and back roads and just cruising. We listened to, like, this one, all these early, like
Blackout, Virgin Killer.
Yeah, I mean, it's like that. I'm like, oh, wow. Man. To me, it opened this world. I mean, but this one stuck with me for the longest time. Like, starts off with Loving You Sunday Morning. I just love the guitar riff, which, I mean, a lot of people would say this is where Scorpions got their
more modern.
Their trademark sound, I guess you would say. Because even the albums before this were a little, different. But the guitar solos, love the guitar solos in Love You Sunday Morning. Another Piece of Meat, which I just love the rock and groove in the Guinness solos. Always Somewhere, kind of like first two songs, and then this kind of took it down a little bit. Not too bad, but took it down a little bit. Coast to Coast, instrumental. I can listen to this for like 3 hours straight. I think they use it in so many different parts of it. I mean, to me, I love it. I just love it. Can't Get Enough. I love the fast tempo, very guitar driven. Is there anybody there? To me, I don't know. This song just doesn't fit the album. It lost me. I don't know.
It's a reggae song.
I think Jimmy Buffett when I hear it. I don't know why.
Yeah. I think Bob Marley when I hear it. Bob
okay,
Marley.
I can see that. But this just loses me. It has an island feel, and I don't know. And then, thank God, they go back to Love Drive. Classic feel and the solo and that song. And Holiday. They close out the album with the... It starts off acoustic start, and then they kind of kick it up a little bit, and then, but you know what? It's weird, but I really like that song. I mean, I don't know what, it's something about it. It's not rocking by any means, but just the guitar and playing in it, like acoustic to the pick it up part. And the album cover, of course, surprised, like the band said, got banned in the United States. They had to come out to, because there was like a guy and a girl in the backseat of a car, and her breast is exposed and his hands coming out like bubble gum. And they laughed, like, Klaus, why not? He said, like, the United States, when they played the United States, girls were flashing their breasts at the concerts and shit. He goes, and here we are, put that album out, and then...
Can't show it.
Out of all the countries, the United States, they were showing their breasts, and then he started to come to the United States, and then the album cover gets banned. But, it made 50, ranked 55 in Billboard 200. Nice. But to me, I mean, this, I remember, as soon as I listened to this, I remember driving the old Chevy pickup truck. I mean, we were driving around drinking a cold beverage, Mountain Dew.
The new Coke.
The new Coke. But,
Crystal Pepsi, you were probably drinking.
Crystal
right?
Pepsi.
What year is that? Oh, God. That might have came out. I think that was later. But, anyways. But, to me, I mean, this opened a whole new non commercialized Scorpions to me.
Right. Cool.
Steve, what do you think?
I enjoy this album. I think it's good. And it's the, like, really the first and, I guess, one of the only albums that has Michael Schenker on there. He was, like, 16 years old, I think, when he started in. in UFO, or I don't know what the timing of it was. I don't know if he went to UFO for, I don't know, whatever. But he was a young guy. His brother Rudolph was like pretty much one of the main guys in the Scorpions, still is. And this is the first album that features Matthias Jabs also. And they're split on the songs of who plays lead. There's three songs pretty much that Matthias is on, and then Michael is the rest of the solos on the album. Loving You Sunday Morning, I like it. I like when it like kicks up, but I don't think it's a great opening song of the album. It's fucking phenomenal live. I don't think it's a great opening song. Another Piece of Meat, I think if they flipped those two, I think maybe that would have been a little bit better. Quick Rocker, rather sexist even for the time. She's just another piece of meat. But he has a weird effect to his voice in the verses on that song. And it's weird because it's a rare instance where Herman Rarebell wrote the lyrics to that song, which is kind of weird. Always Somewhere, meh, boring. Coast to Coast, I'm with you, BC. I could listen to this song just on a fucking loop and just let it play. It's kick-ass. Always one of my favorite parts when you see Scorpions live. Can't Get Enough, another great rocker. Actually, I have this is the song that should have opened the album. This is the song I think that would have been just like right out of the gate, kick ass, and then go into Loving You Sunday Morning, and then the rest of the album I think is okay. Is there anybody out there? Scorpions go reggae. The solo's got a good sound to it though. The solo in it is probably the only part of the song that I enjoy. Lovedrive, really good. The prominent bass sound in this song is really, really good. The vocals are good. The solo's fucking kick-ass. And another Michael Schenker solo. And I'm with you, BC, and I'm not a big ballad guy. I really like Holiday. You know, she will come. And then it kicks in, you know, kicks in a little bit, but then he has a little kind of...
Then goes back.
Little back and forth, and goes back into the slow part. I like how it kind of fades, just kind of... fades away, just kind of like sand on the beach, just like,
and that, like fading that's the song away. That when you hear it takes me back to drive around the backcountry roads.
Yeah and usually wow. and correct me if I'm wrong, BC, a lot of times like that when you listen to an album like that, you'd skip the fucking balance, you'd be like fuck it, yeah. Boom, gone. But this one would be one that you would actually listen to all the way through, and they did it really good live when they first time I saw them was for Love at First Sting album. And they did Still Loving You and Holiday together. And I thought it was a great mix just to, in the middle of the set. And it's good. It's a great song. It translates great live.
I really enjoy this album, Love You Sunday Morning. I thought it was a really, really good opener. It gives you that with the new lineup with Klaus and the two Schenker brothers. I thought this was a really good opener. Another Piece of Meat. Great song. Great guitar work in between the verses. There's like... three solos in there, which are really, really cool. Always Somewhere, it reminded me there's like maybe four notes. It sounds like Freebird. It has like a Freebird sound to it. The first, there's like three or four notes that run simultaneously. It sounds just like Freebird. Coast to Coast, I agree with you guys. Instrumental, but still kick ass. I would have loved it more if they had a little, you know, lyrics to it, but it's still good. Can't Get Enough, highlight of the album for me. Love this song, really, really heavy, awesome solo. You know, it's that classic Scorpions sound that you want to hear. Is there anybody there? Yeah, the reggae Scorpions. I wrote down. You know, I think we're all on the same page at this one. Lovedrive, and I'm a little bit. Opposite of you guys. I would have loved to see this one close the album, because I thought Lovedrive is a really, really good song. It grips you, because for some reason Holiday to me was like a little bit of a weaker closer, but the guitar work in it was really, really good. But if the reggae song wasn't in there, BC, this is a fantastic album.
I agree with you. I like that. Holiday is kind of your closing the album out on a low note, but slower note, I guess.
I can see that.
Just
me. You know, I'm
yeah.
Weird.
Dylan?
This is a great album. I haven't really listened to this album. I've heard a lot of these songs outside of the context of the album, but I'd never listened to it front to back like this. I love the riff and loving You Sunday Morning. It's a, such a... It sounds so cool, and it's instantly one of those recognizable Scorpions riffs that just scream. If you hear it, if somebody was to play that isolated, you'd be like, okay, that sounds exactly like Scorpions. Another piece of meat. I first heard the Vince Neil cover of this off of Tattoos and Tequila.
Yeah.
I had not heard the Scorpions original version of it, but it's good. It's a great song. Always Somewhere is pretty good too. Coast to Coast, I love it. It's a great instrumental. Can't Get Enough is good. Is There Anybody There? I like. It's a different song. I like that they try something.
Oh no, new. I agree with that. But in the context of the album, it just sticks out.
Yeah.
But the guitar tone on that song is probably the best guitar tone on the whole album.
Yeah, it does sound good.
If you just can isolate that, it does. It has a different sound to everything else on that. And that's a Matthias song also.
Lovedrive is a fantastic song. And I honestly love Holiday as the closing song. I think it's a perfect song to end the album with. It has almost a reflective feel to it. And I said before that an album should either end bombastically with a giant bang or on a reflective note, looking back at the past experiences that we've had listening to this album. And I think Holiday does that very well. And I Lovedrive would be a good closer. I prefer Holiday in that spot, and I think it's perfect where it is. Because I don't know where else it would fit as well in the album, because it feels like it would be a come down, and then everything else would be picked back up, and it would balance it. The balance would be off a little bit.
I think that because of the sheer mellowness of how it starts,
yeah,
and then how it kind of fades out.
Starts mellow, comes up, fades up.
Yeah.
It's a nice rolling hill.
All right, guys, there's our four albums from the 70s. If you guys had to pick one album or four to do, if you were going to be say you were on this show, what album would you want? What album would you want to do out there? And I will go around the table once more. And, guys, rank the albums, say goodbyes, and we'll wrap it up. Dylan.
Okay, ranking the albums. So I'm going to go Led Zeppelin 4, Love Drive, Toys in the Attic, Fly Like an Eagle. All right. Fantastic albums. They all have really good things. Are we doing our goodbyes now?
Yeah.
Okay. And honestly, there were a lot of amazing albums in the 70s that we could have picked, and we'll absolutely explore this again, I'm sure. Because there are so many bands and so many different songs and everything, and you might hear some songs later on this month. But there are so many things that we could talk about with this decade, and we picked some pretty good albums, I think. So, yeah, it was a good episode.
Yes, I will go Led Zeppelin 4, Toys in the Attic, BC's pick for Love Drive, and Fly Like an Eagle. I really enjoy this album. I enjoy this episode just because of the concept of not being so familiar with all these albums from way back in the 70s. You know, I had these on cassette, and it's been a long time since I actually sat down and listened to these things. But a great episode, great picks. You know, and I'm glad that everybody tried to get a little bit of a different feel for, you know, something that we really haven't been talking about. You know, Led Zeppelin and Steve Miller and Aerosmith. It's even the Scorps. We really don't get too heavy in them. And it's just a great, great conversation from the decade. And it really, really worked out great.
Yeah, I'm going to go with the Scorpions' Love Drive, Led Zeppelin 4, Aerosmith Toys in the Attic, and Steve Miller with Fly Like an Angel.
An eagle.
Eagle. Don't mind me. But I think there was Dylan that mentioned, I mean, the 70s is very under the radar, I think, as far as good hard, like, not hard rock, but just rock, like a good rock. You got like bands like Aerosmith, Ted Nugent. I mean, there's so much. Yeah. When you really, if you were to sit down and look at it, it's a very underrated decade. But this is fun.
All right. Once again, everybody, thank you for tuning in. We're glad you spent some of your time with us during the week, and we have a great time doing this. And I enjoyed it. And this was a tough episode to pick an album and ask these guys. I had three different albums that I picked. I'm like, I'm changing it again. I'm changing it again. I'm changing it again. And
I
will.
I liked your other albums a lot more.
They're in reserve. So I'll rank the ones too. I'm gonna go with Scorpions first, Love Drive. Then I'm gonna go with Aerosmith. Then I'm gonna go with Led Zeppelin. I'm even gonna put my album last. My albums are always fucking last. But that's okay. But it was fun doing this, and I really like kind of delving into stuff bands we haven't talked about before. And next week's episode is going to be really cool because we're really going to do a cool thing. You're going to hear a lot of different stuff that we've not talked about before on the podcast. And we're going to have an awesome returning guest next week also. So, guys out there, let us know. What's your 70s album? What's your go-to album from the 1970s? Are you a Zeppelin guy? Are you a Sabbath guy? Are you like an under-the-radar guy? Like BC was just checking out some Pat Benatar, dealing with some Blue Oyster Cult. So what's your guys' go-to thing in the 70s? I mean, it could be Deep Purple and, God, there's a million of them out there you could throw out there. And once again, don't forget about the Rockin' Pod Expo. It's going to be August 9th and 10th in Nashville. You can get on rockinpod.com. Check it out. It has all the details there. We'll put a link to the Rockin' Pod on this episode. Don't forget, check out our Spotify playlist. A lot of the songs that we talked about tonight will be on that playlist. And I just want to say thanks, guys, for listening to us. Check it out. Check out the Spotify playlist. Check out all the other cool podcasts out there, the guys we've had guests on here. And thank you guys for tuning in. Take care of yourselves and take care of each other. And we will see you next time. And there will be a next time.